Good afternoon, and welcome to Lehigh University's College of Health Colloquium Series. I'm so pleased that you've joined us. I'm Beth Dolan, the Interim Dean of the College of Health. The Colloquium Series this spring celebrates the launch of our Institute for Health Policy and Politics. I'm super excited about this institute because it's an important component of the research infrastructure of the College of Health, and it will enable us to have a tangible effect on policies designed to improve human health. I'm pleased to introduce the director of the Institute for Health Policy and Politics, Dr. Ed Gomez, who is also an associate professor in the College of Health. Ed will in turn introduce our speaker, Dr. Thomas Bohlke. Ed?
Great, thank you very much, Dean Dolan. And thank you everyone for taking the time to join us today. Excited that you are all joining us wherever you are. And I'm very honored to have Thomas Bohlke, who is the Director of Global Health Programs at the Council on Foreign Relations, join us today. Tom is a Director of Global Health Program and Senior Fellow for Global Health, Economics, and Development at the Council on Foreign Relations. He is also an Adjunct Professor of Law at Georgetown University. He's the author of the book, Plagues and the Paradox of Progress, Why the World is Getting Healthier in Worrisome Ways, and is the founder and managing editor of Think Global Health, an online magazine that examines the ways health shapes economies, societies, and everyday lives around the world. It's certainly an honor for Tom to join us today. And he will be giving a presentation titled Democracy, Trust, and Disease. He will go ahead and give his presentation, then we'll do some question and answers at the end. So if you could please hold on your questions and answers until he's finished with his presentation. So I'd like to turn it over to Tom now. Thank you very much, Tom.
Thank you so much for having me. It's a great pleasure to be here. Always nice to collaborate and work with Ed. And thank you for the invitation to be here. And it's a pleasure to be at Lehigh. My sister is actually an alumnus of the university and had really valued her time here. So I'm really pleased to have the opportunity to speak with all of you. I'm going to share my slides now. Great. So our topic today, again, as Ed mentioned, was Democracy, Trust, and Disease, Lessons from COVID-19. And the way I wanted to proceed in that is with the observation COVID-19 has produced a health crisis, but it's also exacerbated a democracy crisis. We'll talk a little bit as to why. We'll talk then about some of the context, what has been the historical evidence around the linkages between democracy and health outcomes. And then last, we'll talk about the role of trust in the pandemic and how that might interplay with democracy. And then after that, I look forward to a dialogue with all of you assembled here. So COVID-19 produced a health crisis, but it also exacerbated a democracy crisis. The number of countries that are democratizing or experiencing significant improvements in their quality of democracy peaked around 1994, soon after the end of the Cold War, and has been falling ever since. The slogan of the Washington Post, notwithstanding, democracy has really died in darkness during this time. It's been dying in the light, one election at a time, with voters embracing populists who promise to cut the red tape and deliver a better life that democracy has been perceived to be failing to provide. So midnight military coups and backroom deals did not, for instance, bring strong men to power in Nicaragua, Turkey, or Venezuela. These former democracies have joined the world of autocracies really due to everyday frustrations over high healthcare costs, poorly performing schools, corrupt governments, and crumbling bridges that motivated voters in those countries to elect populists. And once in power, cheered on by supporters hungry for results, those populist leaders have openly and steadily undermined the fair elections, free media, and institutional restraints that are the hallmarks of democracy. So this pandemic has been a continuation of that theme, or comes in the context of that theme, where there's a competition for the hearts and minds of and votes of citizens at home. And the same is true really for abroad, as democracy as a system, for its ability to deliver on what the world needs in a crisis. So in terms of at home, the perception, of course, is that many democracies have done worse in this pandemic. That's actually statistically not the case. There isn't a correlation, we'll get to this a little bit later, between democracies and COVID outcomes. But many of the democracies that are perceived to have struggled, I mean, many of the countries rather that are perceived to have struggled the most are, of course, democracies, while there have been some very notable high profile cases of autocracies, China or Singapore or Vietnam, doing quite well in this pandemic and keeping infections and deaths low. The same competition again is happening internationally in terms of the ability for democracies to deliver. It was quite late, 4 or 5 months after the authorization for expanded use of vaccines, before the United States and many other wealthy democracies began opting to donate them to other countries in need. The US from the outset, and like-minded democracies from the outset, were quite generous with cash, but not with doses. And by contrast, many of the countries that were donating early vaccine doses in significant numbers were autocracies, China, Russia, United Arab Emirates, and others. The perception of the struggles of democracies at home, this one in particular, United States that is, and their poor performance in addressing the world's challenges abroad may be taking a toll. These results are from a relatively recent Pew study, so taken, released over the summer, but taken in spring 2001. And it gives an indication of how the perception of US democracy has fallen. That's, of course, not all related to its performance in the pandemic. The US has had other struggles as a democracy at home. But no doubt it does contribute. And you can see the middle bar, which is the voters choosing the option of the US used to being a good example of democracy, has really grown quite large. And it's true even in the US, where fully 72% of the respondents to this Pew survey indicated that the US had used to be a good example of democracy for other countries to follow, but no longer. This is a shift. I mean, historically, the perception of the link between democracy and health was positive. Thomas Jefferson and his fellow signer of the Declaration of Independence, the physician Benjamin Rush, who's pictured here, once argued that it was sick political systems and despotism that produced sick people and disease. The Nobel Prize winning economist Amartya Sen famously argued that freedoms are not only the primary ends of development, they're also among its principal means. But historically, empirical support for those positions, however attractive they may be, have been somewhat limited. Many studies have found that, some studies have found historically there to be a link between democracy and child mortality or infant mortality, but others have not. Democracy has played a modest role in the story of global health. For decades, China and Cuba were famous for providing good health to their populations at low cost. Many of the countries over the last 15 to 20 years that have had the fastest improvements in life expectancy and child mortality have been autocratic. Nations like Ethiopia, Myanmar, Uganda, and Rwanda. These nations are also among the biggest recipients of global health aid historically. The least has gone to democracies. More has been targeting autocracies. So one question is whether that has remained so, and because health needs have shifted. Part of the reason why studies on democracy and health historically have focused on child mortality and infant mortality is it's one of the few health indicators for which there is a good coverage of data, both globally, but also in terms of how far back those data sets go. So democracy studies have tended to focus on those particular health outcomes. But the needs of countries on health have shifted over time. There has been in 1950, there were nearly 100 countries in the world where more than 20% of children under five perished before their fifth birthday. That's no longer true in any region in the world. You have seen prior to the pandemic a significant shift in the share of death and disability calls against infectious diseases, where they no longer represent the majority of premature deaths in any region of the world. During COVID, even with COVID, COVID has represented over the last 2 years the fourth leading cause of death, with the top three all still remaining non-communicable diseases. This is going to continue, and we see here a dramatic shift that's projected in what the health burden in countries are. To give a sense, from Bangladesh in 1990, 28% of its overall health burden were attributed or associated with cancers, diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, and other non-communicable diseases. By 2040, that is projected to reach 82%. So a dramatic shift. And the question is, as the health demands of countries have shifted, whether the role of democracy has been shifting as well. Fortunately, it's easier to assess that because in addition to having better long-run health estimates of the global burden of disease, dating back to 1980, we also have better evidence, more reliable evidence on democracy, and in particular, the Varieties of Democracy Project has really been a step change in the rigor in which by which democracy and democracy-related indicators are assessed, and that data also goes back a significant time. And that allows us to expand the way we think about or expand the assessment of the role of democracy and health. So we looked at that in 1919, before the pandemic. This is a paper in The Lancet, looking at the relationships between democracy and adult health. So health, life expectancy at 15, and then cause-specific mortality, mortality associated to particular diseases and causes in 170 countries between 1980 and 2016. And what we found was twofold. First is that it turns out that the link between or the performance of autocracies and NCDs turns out not to be as positive as the perception is around infectious diseases. So one way we assess that is by comparing adult life expectancy in the 15 countries that had transitioned from autocracy to democracy since 1970 versus the 55 countries that had not made that transition. And here we controlled for HIV because it's one of the rare diseases that disproportionately affects adults that is heavily targeted by aid in democracies and autocracies alike. So we wanted to isolate the effect of political systems on health performance. And what we found in this analysis is that life expectancy at age 15 was 3% higher in countries 10 years after they transitioned to democracy than their counterparts that had not made that transition. Next, we assessed in that paper the degree to which factors such as your democratic experience, a measure of how long you've been a democracy and its quality, as well as GDP or urbanicity, aid or other mortality shocks disasters and what explains what we've seen in terms of patterns of disease outcomes in the countries we looked at in this study. And what we found is democratic experience was more strongly associated with reductions in mortality for cardiovascular diseases, transportation injuries, which are like road traffic injuries, serious cause of death worldwide, cancers. Democracy had a closer tie with mortality reductions of those causes than GDP. And any factor that has a larger effect than GDP globally in health is an important one. We also found this to be true for tuberculosis. We did not find this, however, to be true for most other infectious diseases. We did not find a strong tie between how democracies do or the role of democracy for those factors. The perception we have of these results is that the factors on which democracy appears to have the largest effect are the causes or diseases that democracy appears to have the largest effect are the ones where the quality of the health system matters most. It's not around one-off care or particular a one-off vaccine, but it's around the performance and persistence of your health system overall. And there are also areas which are not particularly targeted by international aid. Certainly relative to some of the infectious disease causes. We found the role of democracy is increasing over time for the diseases for which it matters. And here you see that in the blue part of this stacked bar chart, where it's getting larger over time. So we tried to assess then, what is it about democracy that explains these outsized health effects? Well, it isn't that increases in democracies are making countries wealthier. We actually found because they aren't, we found an ambiguous relationship between improvements in democratic experience and GDP. But we did find that improvements in democratic experience are associated with more government health spending, and they are also associated with fewer deaths from cardiovascular disease. So in thinking about how large this effect is, we estimate that a 1% improvement in democratic stock results in about a 2% reduction in cardiovascular disease deaths, and about a 9% reduction in cardiovascular, TB, deaths from cardiovascular diseases, tuberculosis, transportation injuries, and other NCDs. That doesn't sound like a lot, but between over the time period in our study, the median country between 1995 and 2015 increased their democratic stock nearly 5 points. So it's a significant jump. And what that means is during our study period, that's an estimated difference of 16 million deaths from cardiovascular disease. But because cardiovascular diseases are becoming more prominent in populous countries, you just extended that study period by 2 years, the number would jump up to 21.5 million. So a rather large effect. To make our results more policy actionable, we looked at what aspect of democracy seems to be driving these results, looking at the major categories of what makes a healthy democracy. So suffrage, free and fair elections, free expression, free association, and elected, having a independently elected executive. And what we did there is we looked at what happens if you remove a factor from one of those five areas. And no question, what you find is having all of them produces the best result for any of the diseases that democracy seem to matter. But when you removed free and fair elections, the benefits of democracy on health or on health outcomes from that particular disease disappeared entirely, stopped being statistically significant. We've looked at other areas in which democracy may matter as well. And this is a study by mostly the same group of authors in health affairs that came out last year, looking at the link between democracy and universal health coverage. So access to affordable, effective health services and financial protection from catastrophic loss. And we looked at what link that has with democracies and how it might change in an economic recession, such as a economic recession brought on by a pandemic. What we found is that democracy is positively associated with improvements in universal health coverage and government spending on health. That association is greatest for low-income countries. We also found that democracies are more likely than autocracies, or were more likely than autocracies over our study period, to maintain the progress they were making in universal health coverage, even amid an economic recession, when access to affordable, effective health services matters most. The opposite, of course, is true for autocracies. And this study is a good reminder that the characteristics that enable a government to contain a health crisis or a contagious virus are not necessarily the same as those needed to sustain population health generally, or in this pandemic's aftermath. So one area we looked at after this was the question of what are we seeing in this pandemic? What's driving health outcomes, the differences between health outcomes from COVID-19 in this pandemic? This is a paper that actually just came out last week in The Lancet. The reason we did this study is the pandemic, I mean, I should say from the outset, we know that the pandemic is far from over, and that good data on COVID outcomes are still sparse in many parts of the world. But planning for the next pandemic has already begun. And if policymakers want to limit the damage of the next dangerous disease outbreak, they need a clear understanding of why some nations have done better than others in this one. So we looked in this study at what explains the epidemiological mystery of this pandemic, where you see very large cross-country differences in COVID deaths and infections that don't track the pattern we generally see in infectious diseases, where low-income countries, for the most part, suffer worse. You see great variation of countries that are neighbors with one another. So that's also different than what you ordinarily see. And to do this, we looked at the political, social, economic, and healthcare factors that might explain those differences. We disaggregated or looked separately at the role of infections from infection fatality ratio, the latter being just the proportion of people infected who die. We did that to try to isolate the effects of these factors on prevention versus treatment. We also looked at two different time periods for the pandemic, from January 1st to 2020 to October 15th, 2020, to capture the period that was pre-vaccines and before variants at least were known to have been spreading and contributing to changes in outcomes. And we also looked at the cumulative period, so from January 1st, from 2020 to September 30th, so that we capture the effect once vaccines became available, and also for some of the impact of variants. And what we found here, this is a complicated figure, but don't panic. I'll walk us through. We found is that many of the factors that people identify as making a big difference in this pandemic, from democracy or autocracy, populism, government effectiveness, trust in science, economic inequality, healthcare measures like hospital beds per capita or universal health coverage or measures of access and quality to healthcare, to pandemic preparedness measures like the Global Health Security Index or the Joint External Evaluation, which governments have been using to guide our investments in pandemic preparedness. We found for all of those factors, none of them had a statistically significant relationship with the variation we've seen between countries in either infections per capita or in fatalities. The factor, what did have an effect? Trust. Trust in government and trust in one another, what is referred to as interpersonal trust. And to a smaller extent, government corruption. How big of a difference how large of an effect is it that we observed? How big of an association? Well, what we found, and I'll walk through this table too, is that for the variation of factors that governments can control or could control, like trust and interpersonal trust, they're the largest contributors to variation in infections per capita among these policy amenable factors. Another way of putting that is we did counterfactual, that if reductions or if every country in the world achieved a level of trust that exists at the 75th percentile of countries, which for trust in government is Denmark and interpersonal trust is South Korea, you would find that for trust in government, it would have reduced global infections by 13%. For interpersonal trust, it would have reduced global infections by 40% over the 21-month period assessed in the study. That works out to about 440 million infections. On the fatality side, the big factor, policy amenable factor, was body mass index, mean body mass index, an indicator of obesity, where that represented 11% of the variation we saw in deaths. Again, just among the policy factors that are within a government's control, theoretically through policy. On the fatality side, half of the variation we see globally is attributable to age structure, not something a government can control. And then on the infection side, there's definitely contributors like seasonality or population density or GDP that are matters that governments can't control easily. Why do we think trust is having this effect? Well, we try to look at the pathway by which this might be occurring. And what we found is that higher trust is associated, higher trust in government and higher interpersonal trust. These are on the bottom, your bottom left-hand side of the screen, is associated with higher vaccination rates. You also see an association, particularly with government corruption and reduced mobility, which is an indicator of compliance with social distancing mandates. I do want to point out on the trust effect that we saw it through both periods, so pre-vaccines and post-vaccines. So it appears that trust is having broader effects beyond just its role in vaccination. So to tie this up and to borrow and paraphrase Fyodor Dostoevsky's famous quote about prisons, you can tell a lot about a society by its response to pandemics of infectious disease. Plagues put a mirror to the societies they affect. And pandemics will expose the failures of a government that does not invest in the health of its constituents or address the collective risks that rise when vulnerable groups lack health protections. And what we find on the trust is that in a pandemic with a contagious virus, that the most effective ways for governments, what our study suggests is the most effective way for governments to protect their citizens was by convincing them to adopt the behaviors to protect themselves. And especially in free society, free societies that appears to have depended on trust, trust between those citizens and their government and among themselves. And those differences in the ability to mobilize that trust appear to explain a significant amount of the variation in how countries have performed in this pandemic. It is worth pointing out how anomalous the US is on trust measures. Most countries vacillate within a stable average around trust, both trust in government and in interpersonal trust, trust in others to do the right thing. And I should say these trust indicators, both in the studies came from Gallup and World Value Surveys, long-running standardized surveys. What I show you here is from Pew, just because it's a most recent result. And what you can see there is there has been a dramatic decline in trust of both types in the United States. I'm going to sum up here and then look forward to answering questions about that further. But where I think this leaves us is that the role of democracy and health are increasingly and unavoidably inseparable, but not sufficient for all health demands. And that is particularly important. Democracy is particularly important as aid budgets are stagnant and countries' needs shift to non-communicable diseases, injuries, and adult health. But the qualities that enable governments to contain this pandemic may not be the same for those that are mattering for those diseases. And for the challenges that exist with this pandemic and some infectious diseases, trust may play a larger role because of what it inspires in terms of people's own behaviors and protecting themselves. Let me stop there. I'm really looking forward to the discussion, and thanks again for this opportunity.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Tom. And thank you everyone for listening and participating. I'd like to open up to any questions that the audience may have. If you can please go ahead and put your questions in the Q&A box or go ahead and unmute yourself and ask the question directly. Yes, we have a question here. Any research you would care to talk about, whether your own, current, or future, that addresses impacts on trust in government and others?
Great. We're continuing to look at the role of trust in government and trust in others in health outcomes, both domestically and internationally, and how it interplays with other political, economic, and social factors. People ask me all the time whether or not I was surprised by this trust result that emerged from this Lancet study. And the answer is not at all on trust. Trust for me was actually the lesson of the West Africa Ebola outbreak, where the crisis response was going quite poorly. They really struggled to mobilize support for the vaccine clinical trials. There was popular opposition to the identification of the infected. There were leaders and local witch doctors promoting the use of poisonous cures, which in some instances killed people. The way that was turned around is the ministries of those local ministries of those governments working with international NGOs engaged in a targeted community specific programs to try to rebuild the trust in the response to the pandemic. Keep in mind the three countries affected in West Africa were post-conflict impoverished nations, Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea. and by bringing in local community leaders, youth leaders, moms, to training them to do the identification of the sick, they were able to have more success with that. Doing parades and celebrations of survivors in communities increased confidence in the government response to the pandemic. Using community leaders or engaging them in the vaccine clinical trial process increased support for those clinical trials. I'm not surprised. There are results in other pandemics and epidemics of the role of trust and adoption of protective behaviors. So that's not, none of that is I think should surprise anyone. What I think is surprising is how little capacity mattered or appears to have mattered in this pandemic. That many countries with very little healthcare capacity or very little pandemic, what we thought of as pandemic preparedness and response capacity, many countries with very poor assessments of their capacities in those regards did quite well in the pandemic. And the opposite is true for some countries that had very rich capacities in those regards, including the United States.
Thank you, Tom. That's very interesting. those of us studying the politics of global health, we've always thought that capacity and state capacities is important for responding, and they're very interesting findings. The next question is, what do opposing political viewpoints usually argue against the observations between democracy and population health, and how do you usually respond to these claims?
So I think most of the skepticism about the role of democracy in health comes in a couple of buckets. One is that, are there unobserved factors that are really driving studies that have found these results? You know, democracies by and large tend to be wealthier. Is there some tie to wealth? So that's certainly one question you get. One question I get a lot is around the role of free and fair elections. So this is the other area. There's some dispute about whether voters really vote on their policy outcomes or whether they're voting on cultural preferences or identification with a particular candidate. And if there isn't as clear of a tie between elections and democracy, what explains their health outcomes? Health is also a long-run indicator. Where, how do people know if a government policy is improving their health when the outcomes of those policies won't be known for a particular time? So you get that, which is one of the reasons why we looked at UHC and financial risk protection, because that's something more immediately experienced. But these are all, it's a really great question. We do our best to control for factors on the democracy side to limit the potential confounders of our results. And we look for factors that may have a more immediate impact on people's lives and health so that we can tie that to elections. And it may be, as we've seen in this pandemic, our results don't suggest a strong tie between democracy and most infectious diseases. And it may be that societies require something more, that the bar for democracies in a health crisis like this one is higher than it is for autocracies. And some of that may be trust, some of that may be other factors as well. And that's an area we're looking into.
Great, thank you. Any other questions? If you don't mind, I have a question for you, Tom. I was really amazed as well by the importance of trust. And you mentioned in your presentation South Korea as one that had this strong interpersonal levels of trust. And, of course, those of us studying American democracy know that establishing trust has been very challenging. What can governments do to encourage, or what lessons could we possibly learn from the case of South Korea? Of course, you know, building trust and culture and trust is obviously something that can't be done overnight. And some would argue there's some historical, a lot of factors that go into that. But is there any kind of institutions? And one, I've studied Brazil for my career, and one of the factors that has helped in Brazil is sort of civic participatory institutions and people attending these institutions and sort of discussing how they're going to respond in their communities. They existed before COVID on a range of health issues. Are there any maybe institutional lessons on that South Korea is doing, or any other lessons that maybe other policymakers learn about and to try and build interpersonal trust? Did you discover anything around those lines?
Great. So a couple of things I would say. Terrific question, Ed. I think of trust in the pandemic context as both a short-term and a long-term project. The short-term project is what I refer to with West Africa, where risk communication, targeted community engagement made a difference in mobilizing an effective epidemic response in low trust societies. And if it seems to you perverse to compare the United States to Sierra Leone, Liberia, and Guinea, know that all three of those countries have higher levels of trust in government than the United States. There's records of what needs to be done in a crisis in a low trust environment. The CDC, in its inaugural pandemic preparedness policy in 2006, talks about the paramount of importance because of this trust issue to have targeted community-specific, consistent, clear, transparent engagement as being of the utmost importance in an effective pandemic response. We just struggled to follow that policy consistently. Mm-hmm. Not just the United States, some other countries as well, or some other governments, I should say, as well. But is being in a low trust environment does not indicate matters are hopeless for a pandemic response, but it does require specific strategies and for them to be implemented consistently and rigorously. On the long-term project of building trust, Ed's right. There's a lot of this that seems almost cultural. As I mentioned before, countries, what's fascinating is, you know, trust measures are done in surveys. We rely on global surveys, in particular the World Values Survey and Gallup. And there's lots of debate in the academic literature, you know, what do people really think they're answering in these trust questions? And for interpersonal trust, it's, do you trust other people to do the right thing most of the time? Without defining what that right thing is, the respondent does that on their own. And a couple things come out. Those survey results are remarkably consistent for most countries. Again, they vacillate within a average. And they tend to be among the most answered questions in those surveys, which suggests respondents aren't struggling with them, and that the responses across different respondents over the years tend to have some consistency. The US is, again, anomalous in that it has really had a decline. It hasn't been consistent in its trust levels. So there's lots of debate about what needs to be done to fix this. There's really trust within a community that you perceive as like you, trust across communities, of including members that you perceive to be different from you, and then trust along an authority gradient, like trust with your physician, trust with the police. It's easy to see how low trust in the US across those three networks may have impacted how we've responded to this pandemic. Again, a lot of it is transparency and effectiveness of government. What we did find in our study is there is a correlation between interpersonal trust and income inequality and government corruption, suggesting people that view themselves as economically, socially, and politically marginalized, not surprisingly, are less inclined to trust others. and addressing those, maybe addressing some of those challenges as a long-term project.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We have a question here. Do you believe the rise of social media contributed to the decline of trust in government?
I definitely believe the rise of social media contributed to lack of trust in government in the pandemic response. There have been surveys. So there are two things I'd point out to that we did a dedicated series in the BMJ around democracy and health. And two of the studies in there I thought were fat. I mean, all of them were good, but two of them really stood out to me. One was surveys at different points of time in the UK, India, and the US, which found that respondents did not hold their leaders responsible for the performance in the pandemic, that they viewed the pandemic as somewhat sui generis. Again, suggesting that there may not be a link between how voters will, where they put their ballots and how people perceive their countries may have done or the governments may have performed in the pandemic. The second was a study on social media and disinformation. And one of the benefits of democracy is that unlike autocracies, there's a free media and health guidance can emerge and can be responded to from the government. When you have the level of disinformation and misinformation that has occurred on social media, that breaks the second tie around freedom of expression and free press in a democracy. And when government voters don't actually hold their politicians accountable for performance in the pandemic, that suggests it breaks the other tie with democracy, which is again around free and fair elections.
Great, great. Thank you very much. The next question from the audience is, what impact does the level of diversity or homogeneity of a population in a democracy have on the level of trust and perception of free and fair elections?
It's a really great question. We did not look at that in this study, but others have, and they've looked at diversity in a couple of different ways. People have looked at that at ethnic diversity, religious diversity. Some studies have looked at it at the proportion of immigrants in a country. They tend to have mixed results. So I wish I could give you a clear answer, but I think the jury is, you're asking the right question. And I think the jury is out as to what the verdict will be on how much that matters, but you're asking the right question.
Great, great, thank you. Another question a participant has is the prevalence of a specific disease in a particular racial group in a population impacted by politics?
I don't know is the short answer. I would say in the context of the pandemic, certainly in the earlier phase of this pandemic in the United States, there were disproportionately poor outcomes among minority racial groups. That's both for indigenous populations as well as for Black Americans, Latinx populations, and so forth. That has largely, the disparities have declined over time. It is not clear, sadly, that that's being driven by better health engagement. There has been higher rates of vaccine hesitancy among white populations in the United States. And some of the disparities we've seen in COVID outcomes have dissipated over time because of that. That would be as far as I could go to answer that good question.
Sure. Great, great. Thank you very much. Wonderful. Any other questions from the audience? All right. Well, this was fantastic, Tom. I really appreciate it. I really learned a lot. And certainly we'll be assigning your articles to my global health class next time. I really enjoyed the trust article. I find that's very fascinating. And it goes against a lot, as I mentioned earlier, the assumptions that people have had in public health about capacity. We read Scott Greer's, which I'm sure you know, book on COVID politics in our class. And sort of some of the indicators you mentioned that were not important were important in their case studies, such as capacity, for example. You know, South Korea also being one of those that having strong capacity. So I think that's very important. And I think that level of trust and discussions about that, is something that all of us are concerned about, especially in the U.S. and what could be done and what can we learn from other, smaller countries that are doing a lot more in this area and with weaker capacity. I mean, your work really shows that it's not all about often investing in capacity, although important. There are some there's some other issues and trust issues that we need to really work on as a society in the U.S. So thank you so much for this. It's been wonderful learning from your work and learning more about what you're doing. And I'd just like to encourage anyone, if there's any follow-up questions, I'm sure Tom has his email displayed, or I can pass along any other questions. And I'd like to thank you very much for joining us today and for being involved here in our virtual community here at Lehigh. Thank you.
Great. It's my great pleasure. Really nice to spend a little time with all of you today.
Great. Thank you so much. And before everyone leaves today, I'd like to go ahead and share with you some upcoming event. So on March 29th, Dr. Fonti Panagakos, Associate Dean for Research in West Virginia University, will be giving a presentation in our next colloquium series titled Putting Oral Health Back into Overall Health, Science, Policy, and the Future. So if you do have time and are interested in joining our next colloquium, please go to this link and register, and we'll be providing social media and email information follow-up on this event. And I'd like to thank all of you for joining us. We look forward to seeing you again at our next colloquium series. And I hope everyone has a wonderful day, and we will see you soon. Thank you very much.